Darling, what's wrong? You all right?
Yes, I'm all right.
Why are the tears?
I don't know. Just one of those things.
What things? You don't cry for no reason.
I don't keep on about it. It's nothing, really.
You just felt like crying.
Sorry.
You don't have to apologize.
The judge paid me a compliment today.
That's enough to make anyone cry. A compliment for what?
My lack of emotion.
Mm-hmm.
Some parents were suing a nursing home for the death of their son. He was only 9.
And you lost?
We won. But it meant nothing to the parents. They wanted their son back.
It's knocked you out, hasn't it?
I'd have felt the same if it had been Michael. Thank God for music.
Thank God for you.
And for you.
Well, go on. Don't stop there.
Chopin's making us maudlin.
Surely you can express your feelings, Harriet. They're not going out on the 10 o'clock news.
It's all been said.
Not by us.
We don't have to go on about it. Never seek to tell thy love. Love that never told.
Harriet, you're putting up the barricades.
I'm not.
You simply don't want to commit yourself.
If you like.
All I want is to marry you. I shan't take away your independence.
Sounds like the promised land.
It could be.
Probably would be.
Do you mean that?
Yes, I do.
Well, then.
Like some coffee?
No, no, listen, it won't mean flower arranging and cocktail parties and handing around the gherkins. It won't mean chatting up the grocer and weeding the borders. It'll mean joining forces with me. We could work together. Barrister and doctor fighting for a better system. Better for the people you want to protect. Better for the people I want to help. Put dangerous men inside forever, if necessary, but at least make it possible for them to live in decency. Let them see their wives. Share a bed together. Give them proper work to do and a proper wage. Perhaps even a trade union.
Oh, come on, Ian, come back to reality. The idea's too radical.
So is the National Health Service, but we've got it.
Well, people would need an awful lot of persuading.
Exactly. And you, with your talent for advocacy, could do it.
I'm not sure I could.
Harriet, I need you. I need your help.
It's not my line of country.
Why not?
I don't feel as strongly about people as you do. It's something I envy you very much. Something I admire. I'm too selfish. I'm still trying to win my own little war.
What war?
I need to prove that I'm as good as the best of them. So that I can say to myself, you've done it. You're a woman and you've beaten the system.
I simply don't understand you. A moment ago, you said it sounded like the promised land.
All right. I'm perverse.
Especially on the subject of marriage.
Part of me wants to marry you. The other, the ambitious part, doesn't. And yet I don't want to lose you.
You want the best of both worlds.
Don't you?
Then what's the answer?
I don't know. Ian, I'm thinking of applying for silk.
So that's it. Your private ambition, Harriet Peterson, QC, and to hell with us.
I don't think I shall get it.
Why? Because of what you did for me?
We agreed not to talk about that. You don't want me to apply?
You do what you like.
Come in. What is it, Bill?
The solicitors want to know when the Mackay papers will be ready.
I haven't had them a week.
I know, but they put on the papers dispatchable obliged.
Solicitors always do that. Well, they'll have to wait. There are one or two more urgent matters I haven't even touched yet. And isn't there a conference this afternoon?
I hate to have to tell you, Miss Peterson, but there are six more briefs outside.
How many with dispatchable oblige on them?
None.
Good.
But two of them have expedition specially requested.
Sit down a moment, Bill. I can't stand much more of this paperwork. If I go on at the bar...
If you go on at the bar? Well, Sir John would be very upset if you were to leave.
If I go on, I shall have to apply for silk. What do you think?
I should wait until next year.
Another year of all this? I suppose what you mean is until people have forgotten about the case of Dr. Moody.
Oh, am I interrupting?
Yes. No.
Do I smell a conspiracy?
Thank you, Bill. You want something, John?
Mine will keep. What does he advise?
Wait for a year.
Excellent advice. Disregard it.
I think you mean that. But I shall have to decide soon. It isn't fair to Ian.
Well, why should you be fair? He's old enough to take care of himself. Every marriage is a gamble. You've had one disaster. You might be an excellent wife, you might not. I simply don't know. But I do know that you're a success at the bar, and you've got the ability to go all the way if you want to. It's a choice between backing a certainty and a doubtful runner.
He won't wait forever.
I should hope not. Is that brutal?
Yes.
I'm sorry, but what do you expect me to say? I want to keep you at the bar. Your profession needs you. And what's more, Harriet, I think you'll need your profession.
If I apply, who should I get to support my application?
Well, the normal thing is two High Court judges. Three will be overdoing it. What about Bezenket?
I'm sure he'd help.
Then there's Musgrave. I should think his word would go a long way.
Well, I've been in front of him several times in the past year and done fairly well, I think.
Well, he can be difficult, but he's susceptible to women, such as our frailty.
Oh, I don't think he dislikes me.
Then there are your two men. I'll get William to make the appointment for you.
Not so fast. I haven't made up my mind yet.
You mustn't let anything I say influence you more than usual.
I won't.
By the way, there is one small thing you might help me with.
Of course, John.
While you're still a junior.
What do you mean?
I want you to take a pupil, a rather particular pupil.
How can I say no?
I do see the difficulty.
What sort of pupil?
Well,
Is he clever?
She is very.
She?
My niece. She's in my room. Do come along and meet her. I can't stand the woman. Harriet, may I present my niece, Phyllis Bradstreet? Phyllis, this is Miss Peterson.
How do you do?
How do you do?
Now, I've asked her if, out of the kindness of her heart, she will take you as a pupil.
I shall be most grateful if you can take me. I'm sure you won't regret it.
How nice of you to be so confident.
Well, that's quite all right. Uncle John tells me you're terribly busy. I expect I shall be able to take some of the load off your shoulders.
Have you any idea what it's like being in chambers?
I've been with Harford for about 6 months. By the time I left him, he was relying on me a good deal. In fact, he asked me to stay on.
Why didn't you?
Too specialized a practice. I wanted something a little more like yours. Uncle John has told me all about you.
Really? Do you think I could learn a little bit more about you?
Perhaps you could go into the details later, Harriet. I'm sure you'll get on like a house on fire.
Oh, not so fast, John. I might want to put her out.
It was the same with Harford. He nearly flung me out the first day. He ended up by trying to seduce me.
I can assure you that that won't happen in this case.
Well, I meant from going to other chambers.
Ah.
Phyllis, I do hope you realize that Miss Peterson is only taking you as a personal favor to me. She doesn't take pupils normally. You're a very lucky young woman.
Perhaps we both are.
Yes, on that happy note, Harriet, I'm sure you'd like to take Phyllis and show her your room.
There's not much room, I'm afraid. You can use that desk.
Gosh, it's tiny. My previous room was much bigger. How on earth do you manage?
Somehow. You better study these. There's a conference at 2:30. You can come to it if you like, but you will keep quiet, won't you?
Uncle John's rather splendid, isn't he?
Splendid.
Will you ever take silk?
Who knows?
I shall. When I was a kid, I used to think that becoming a QC was like getting a knighthood. Instead of just becoming a really rather super barrister.
If the Lord Chancellor appoints you.
Do you know him?
Who?
The Lord Chancellor.
Not personally.
He's rather sweet, really.
I have no doubt.
You've had to work hard, haven't you?
Very. I still do.
I'm lucky. I have a particularly good memory. I think if you're going to get anywhere in this job, it's rather necessary.
I'm sure.
Harford used to say, Phyllis, why are you always bloody well right? He used to get furious, poor old thing. I suppose it must be humiliating, especially for a man. When Uncle John used to say, being right is the most unforgivable quality in a woman.
I can see what he meant.
Yes, I do find it difficult. Do you?
What?
Find it difficult.
At the moment, very. Would you mind giving this to Bill? It's rather important.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize.
Nor did I.
Yes, okay. Well, I'll call you back then. Goodbye.
Miss Peterson asked me to give you this. It could be my notice.
No such luck. Please make an appointment with Mr. Justice Bosanquet and Mr. Justice Musgrave. Good for you, Harriet.
Dr. Moody, please. Oh. When will he be back? I see. No message, thank you. Hell.
Peterson, sir.
Oh, come in, Miss Peterson.
Very good of you to see me, Judge.
Not a bit. Do sit down.
Thank you.
Oh, what can I do for you?
I'm proposing to apply for silk, and I wondered whether I could quote you in support of my application.
Ah, I had a suspicion that's what it was. Well, I'm sure you've given it a lot of thought. I know a growing number of barristers think the distinction between juniors and QCs should be done away with. You obviously don't.
No, I don't. For me, as a woman, the status means rather a lot. Call it ambition, dedication, what you will. It's something I want to achieve.
Harriet Peterson, QC. Yes, yes, I think I can see that. Is it too early for you to have a glass of sherry?
I don't want to be a nuisance, Judge.
Oh, good gracious. It'll give me an excuse. I think if I were Lord Chancellor, my only hesitation in recommending you for silk would be the thought that you might get married and leave the profession.
I don't think that's very likely. Sure. I've been married once, Judge, and I'm afraid it wasn't a success. Thank you.
You were divorced?
I divorced my husband.
Oh, that's all right. I'm sorry. It's just that certain questions might be asked.
May I ask you a rather personal question, Judge?
What is it?
Do you think the Dr. Moody case will affect my chance of getting silk?
It might. I can only say that personally I hope it won't.
Thank you.
Time does fly. I remember you appearing before me in your early days. It was in Newcastle, wasn't it?
Quite right. What a marvelous memory you have.
I have a splendid memory for the good things in life, but I forget the bad as fast as I can. I thought you'd get on, and I'm delighted that you have.
I hope I wasn't too arrogant.
Oh, no.
Now, there's all the difference between confidence and arrogance. Confidence is very important in an advocate. First-rate advocacy can affect judges almost as much as juries. Do you want to be a judge eventually?
I should have thought that was impossible now.
Oh, I don't see why. It was unfortunate in the Moody case that your relationship with him had to be made public, but that should be forgotten in a few years' time.
I must say, I would like to be considered for the bench one day.
Well, it's a job I enjoy. But it does mean you're cut off a good deal from your friends at the bar. That's why I'm taking up so much of your time now.
I can understand that.
Tell me, who else have you got to support your application?
I'm going to see Mr. Justice Musgrave after I leave you.
Hmm. Well, I'm sure he'll be helpful.
Oh, Miss Peterson, how did it go?
I'd rather not say.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, by the way, Dr. Moody called. He's in London. He left a number.
Get him for me, will you, Bill?
Hmm.
Hello?
Come on.
Ian?
Yeah.
Didn't recognize your voice. How are you?
Fine.
Did you ring about tonight?
Yes.
Well, is it still on?
Of course it's still on. I mean, if you'd like to.
Well, of course I would. Will you pick me up at the flat?
No, I can't make it there.
Well, shall I meet you at the restaurant then?
Yes, that'd be better.
What time?
8:30.
All right. Hello? Hello?
Oh, sorry. Am I interrupting?
Finished.
How did it go?
Not my day. Mr. Justice Musgrave turned me down.
Turned you down?
I'm afraid I don't know you well enough. I knew what he meant.
Oh, God. I could kick myself for suggesting him. Damn prude. What about Bosanquet?
He was sweet. Couldn't have been more helpful.
Hmm. How about trying Crawley?
No, thank you. I'm not trying any more judges. Do you think you know me well enough?
Well, a QC doesn't carry as much weight as a judge, but you can put me down. I'd do anything to help.
Thank you, John. You're very good to me.
Sorry I'm late.
I was beginning to think I'd been stood up.
Have you ordered?
No, I waited for you.
That makes a change.
I didn't hear from you all week. Why didn't you ring me?
Why didn't you ring me?
I did. You weren't in. I missed you.
Waiter.
Evening, madam. Evening, sir.
What would you like to eat?
Not very hungry.
What?
I'm not very hungry.
Well, what are we doing here?
Dover soap.
Kebab.
And would you care for some?
No, nothing.
You're in a stroppy mood.
How's your application going?
1-4, 1-against.
So you're not a judge yet?
I can do without sarcasm. How's your day been?
Why bother to ask? You're not really interested.
Ian, I've had a bloody awful day.
I've had a bloody awful week. I've done nothing but think of you.
How do I take that?
I'm seriously beginning to wonder if it's worth the effort. It's all very much one way, isn't it?
Don't talk rubbish.
I'm thinking of applying for silk. That's what you said. Not do you think I should apply?
I don't happen to be devious.
You could have considered my feelings.
I did. It was like jelly when I told you. I knew you'd take it the wrong way.
A kick in the stomach's a kick in the stomach.
That's why I didn't tell you at once.
I thought you weren't devious.
I didn't want to hurt you.
You never get me a thought.
My God, are we that far apart?
Throughout our entire relationship, I've always had to compromise. You've never once compromised.
Look, if we're going to have a slanging match, let's have it in private.
It's always been what Harriet wants.
You refuse to see it from my point of view.
I've got cross-eyed seeing it from your point of view. I'm sick to death of seeing it from your point of view.
What a hypocrite you are. You make out you're the understanding, liberal, the broad-minded humanist, but underneath you're just like the rest of your breed, a Victorian bully. You don't want a wife, you want a bloody housekeeper.
And you don't want a man, you want a bloody mat. You're a typical career woman. Selfish, hard-faced, ruthless.
And this is all because I didn't say, Ian, darling, please advise me, because I'm a weak, foolish little woman and you're so big and strong and wise.
I'm not surprised one of the judges gave you the thumbs down. You have no sensitivity, no humanity.
No humanity? Thank you very much. My God!
Excuse me, madam. Is anything the matter?
No, thank you, officer. I'm quite all right.
Can I see your driving license and insurance certificate?
Why? I haven't had an accident.
No, but I wouldn't like to see you come any closer. May I ask if you've had anything to drink?
Well, yes, yes, I have. Two glasses of sherry.
Two glasses of sherry?
Are you going to breathalyze me?
Would you mind getting out of this car and showing me your driving license and insurance certificate? Harriet Joan Peterson. You the barrister, madam?
Yes.
I see. May I ask why you were crying?
You may ask, but I see no reason why I should answer. It's a purely personal matter.
Well, you were driving like a maniac, if I may say so.
I've never seen one drive.
You might very easily have killed someone.
Who? A motorist, a pedestrian, a cyclist?
Any of them.
Have you got their names and addresses?
Well, of course not. I was following you.
No one's been hurt. You've no witnesses to say I did anything I shouldn't have done.
I'm a witness, madam.
Besides yourself, I mean. May I have my certificate and my driving license back, please?
You are aware that it's an offence not to sign your driving license?
Haven't I? Oh, I'm sorry. I must have overlooked it.
It is advisable to check on these things.
Thank you. Anything else I can do for you, officer?
I shall make a full report when I get back to the station. In the meantime, I must warn you that you may be charged with careless or dangerous driving.
When will I know?
When the matter's been fully considered.
When will that be?
Any time in the next 2 months.
Well, could I ask for any letter to be sent to me at my chambers? 14. Old Court. Temple EC4. Anything else wrong?
You can proceed, madam. I'll see that you're kept fully informed.
Thank you. Good night, officer.
Good night.
Thank you, Walker.
Would that be all, sir?
Yes, thank you.
Good night, Sir John.
Good night. Hello?
John?
Harriet?
I'm sorry to ring you at this hour, but I had to talk to somebody.
What on earth's the matter?
I may be prosecuted for dangerous driving.
Anyone hurt? Accident even, but it was a pretty near thing.
Huh. I thought at least you'd killed a copper. Why are you so upset?
Ian and I had a frightful scene in a restaurant. I stormed out and drove like a maniac.
Dear, oh dear. What's the evidence against you?
That a policeman followed me.
Anyone?
Yes.
That's lucky. Did you make any admission to him?
No. I should have. I behaved outrageously and I should have said so.
99% of the population would disagree with you. They'd say it's up to the police to prove it.
That's no excuse.
The question is whether they'll prosecute. He warned you, I suppose.
Yes, he said he'd make a full report. John, if they do prosecute and I plead guilty, do you think it'll affect my application?
Very likely the prosecution wouldn't take place until after the silks had been chosen.
Yeah, I thought of that. What if I'm unlucky?
Depends how the evidence comes out.
But frankly, I don't think for a moment that they'll prosecute. Now listen, you must put it out of your mind. Drown your sorrows in work. Which reminds me, I want you to do something for me.
Not another pupil.
Good God, no. Good of you to take on Phyllis, by the way.
To let her take me on, you mean?
What is it, then?
Well, I'm supposed to be sitting as recorder at Great Church next week. But in view of the Allenby case, which looks like going on for weeks, it would be very awkward for me indeed. Now, will you sit for me?
I thought you couldn't appoint a deputy recorder any longer.
Well, you're quite right, but I've asked the Lord Chancellor's department if they'll appoint you as deputy judge, and they've agreed if you will, so they can't think too badly of you.
You did this for my morale, didn't you?
Good God, no. It's simply that I can't afford to sit myself, and you can't afford not to.
One of these days, I'll do something for you, John.
I can hardly wait. Have you sent in your application for silk?
No, I'm going to do it in the morning. Do you know anything about the list at Great Church?
Not a thing. It's not usually very heavy.
What's it like sitting as a judge?
Lonely eminence. A curious sense of peace. Instead of being in the ring, fighting for one side or the other, searching the whole time for a chink in your opponent's armor, you sit aloft, not caring which side wins. Sentencing can sometimes be a bit of a headache. I shall be very interested to see what you make of it.
So shall I. At the moment, I feel quite incapable. I don't know what's going to happen.
Now, be careful, Harriet. You've had a lot of strain lately.
Yes, I'm very tired.
Now get yourself a hot water bottle, a glass of milk, and a stiff whiskey. Can't beat it. You'll wake up a new woman.
What a lovely thought. All right, John. Thank you. I'm sorry I troubled you.
Not at all, my dear. Good night.
Good night. Lonely eminence.
On January 21st last, at 10:35 a.m., the down platform at Manton Station was full of passengers waiting for the train due to arrive at 10:37. At the time, however, there was a goods train carrying petrol standing at the platform. Nevertheless, the accused, Sigmund Mead, deliberately gave the green light to the passenger train, which was a quarter of a mile away from the station, round a bend in the line, so that the engine driver could not see the stationary goods train. Having signaled the passenger train through, the accused then suddenly changed his mind, left his signal box, and rushed down the line and stood in front of the oncoming train with his arms out. The driver just had time to stop, but the accused plainly risked his life in warning the driver in that way. Subsequently, he was questioned as to what had happened. At first, he said it was an accident, but later he admitted that this was untrue. I quote his actual words. "I'd had a flaming row with a wife. I didn't care what happened. I wanted to die, so I put the signal at green. Then it suddenly hit me. Other people would die and not me. There was nothing else I could do, so I rushed in front of the train to stop it. I wish it had killed me. I am terribly ashamed." The accused is aged 38, has never been convicted of any offence, and has an excellent 20-year record with a railway. He is married with two children, and apart from this offence, has the highest possible character.
Thank you, Mr. Tapworth. Well now, Mr. Mead. You've refused to let counsel defend you. Is there anything you wish to say?
You wouldn't understand. I mean, you wouldn't see red like I did. I was like a madman.
But why?
You wouldn't understand.
How can we if you don't tell us? You must trust us a bit, Mr. Mead. We do know something about life. Even about people seeing red and not caring whether they kill anyone or not.
Well, she called me a bastard.
Your wife? That's why you nearly caused a terrible disaster.
And I know it sounds nothing but like that, but it's true. I mean, that's what did it. That was it. Well, I was brought up in Barnardo's and she knew it.
I see.
I don't know what happened. I just lost control. I went storming out of the house. I didn't know nothing till I suddenly realised what I'd done. And then I ran like mad. And by miracle, I managed to stop the train. Look, I swear, miss, I mean, something just but took hold of me. Now, don't ask me what, because I don't know. I just want to pay the price and forget. She's She's been a good wife, and I've got a good family, and I'm sorry. But I'm sorry, because I could have killed all them people. God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Mead. The bench will now retire to consider sentence.
All rise.
Mrs. Arrow, Captain Glint. This is the first time I've sat in this capacity. So although I control the proceedings in court, please don't think I intend to do the same thing out here.
The softening up process. Don't worry, Miss Peterson, you can rely on us.
I'm afraid I'm out of my depth.
Let it pass, Captain. I'm sure Miss Peterson understands.
What's your impression, Captain Glint?
Oh, ladies first, please.
On the whole, I think we should fine him. Better if some penalty were imposed, and sending him to prison will do no good.
Well, I think we owe it to the public to ensure it doesn't happen again. I think the fellow should be taught a lesson.
But he's learned his lesson. What's the good of sending him to prison?
But the lesson might have been learned at the expense of a terrible loss of life.
Have you never lost control of yourself?
Yes.
I must confess, I lose my temper sometimes.
There, but for the grace of God. Mm. The public must be protected from this sort of thing.
Are you suggesting that if we don't send this man to prison, other signalmen may be tempted to do the same sort of thing?
No, I'm not. I'm saying that the public is entitled to have the knowledge that the offender has been properly dealt with. There would justifiably be a feeling of outrage if we were to let him off with a caution.
But I don't suggest that he be let off with a caution. I suggest a fine, say £50, payable by instalments.
If a party of children had been killed, including a child of our own, could we have felt the same?
I expect my feelings would have been entirely taken up with my grief. There would have been no desire for revenge.
I wish I could agree. I could have no doubt about the penalty.
Luckily, he stopped the train in time. If he started off 3 seconds later, he'd have been charged with murder.
Yes. Funny thing. The fellow's just like one of my father's undergardeners.
May I ask what that's got to do with the case, Captain?
Well, nothing at all. I thought you might be interested. In my view, we should send him to prison for 12 months. I've sat on several courts-martial, don't you know? Of course, we've always had some legal johnny just tell us what to do.
I hope I haven't told you what to do.
I think you would like to.
Certainly not. I want to hear both your points of view.
Very well, then. You might consider the man's wife and children. Mm-hmm. If we send him to prison, we're punishing them as well.
Well, the wife was involved.
Shall we send her to prison, too?
Well, it was she who drove him out of his mind.
So, a sentence of imprisonment is partly to punish the wife.
Well, certainly, there can be no doubt about it.
In my view, that would be an outrage. I could never agree.
Well, Miss Peterson, what's it to be?
Albert Mead. After careful consideration of this case, the bench are satisfied that whatever further domestic problems you may have, you're not likely to behave in this criminal way again. We have also taken into consideration the suffering you've already endured since the incident. For these reasons, we're going to take a lenient course with you. You will be fined £50, payable at the rate of £5 a month. I hope that you will now be able to put the matter behind you. Hello, Bill. Anything happened?
Oh, you've finished, have you, Miss Peterson?
Yes, quite an interesting list. Any urgent messages?
I've left a pile of work on your desk. Oh, and a communication from the police.
I can guess what that is.
Two tickets for the police ball.
From the commissioner himself.
Pays to keep him with the law.
I hope that's what he thinks. Bill, I'd love a cup of tea.
Oh, I'll see what I can do. Oh, by the way, Dr. Moody called earlier.
Did he leave a message?
No, that was all. Get Miss Peterson a cup of tea, will you?
Bill? Hmm? Is Sir John free?
Yes, I believe he is. He can't get 24 across, by the way. The answer's Potter's Bar.
Come in. Where the man at the wheel can drink.
Potter's Bar.
Of course. What a fool I am. Thank you, Harriet. You've restored my self-respect. How did you get on?
Quite well, I think. I must say I didn't relish sitting in judgment on a man whose mistake was not much worse than mine. By the way, I've heard from the police. Much sooner than I thought. They've let me off with a caution.
Oh, what a relief. I had lunch with Harold Plant. Rather disgusting, actually. The food, I mean.
Harold Plant?
Lord Chancellor's permanent secretary.
Oh, of course.
We were at prep school together. Got a hell of a whacking from the Greek mistress, I remember. Been a misogynist ever since.
Good morning, Lord Chancellor.
Good morning, Harold. Oh, please, please, do sit down. I'm in a bit of a rush this morning. The PM wants me to see the French ambassador, but before I get caught up with that, I thought I'd have a preliminary word with you about the new silks. They're my first lot.
Any of them worrying you in particular?
Two. One of them is married to one of my godchildren.
Oh, Bill Medway, you mean?
Yes, and the other is Harriet Peterson. But let's take young Medway first. You know, there's a bit of a problem in his case.
You mean the conviction?
Yes.
Well, he travelled first class with a second class ticket. Said he intended to pay the excess, but forgot.
Damn fool to do a stupid, silly thing like that. How long ago was it?
Just on 2 years.
Hmm. I think I'll leave it to my successor.
Rather hard he should have to wait all that time just because you're his wife's godfather.
Well, that's his bad luck. I look upon all silks as potential judges. Personally, I'd never appoint a man as a judge with that sort of conviction against him.
He's paid his fine. Has he also to be disqualified for life?
Well, I don't see why not. I don't think one can be, too careful about the private character of judges. I wouldn't bar him from becoming a silk. But I'm not going to make him one. Not yet, anyway. So much for him.
Right.
Now, what about Harriet Peterson?
She's got a lot of work and a good reputation at the bar.
Meaning?
Well, there was that case, the one involving Dr. Moody. Personally, I rather admired her courage.
Yeah, so did I. But you know, admiration is one thing and approval is another. What else do you know about her?
One grown-up son. She divorced her husband on the ground of desertion, long before she met Moody.
Not a discretion case?
No.
Good. Nothing else against her?
Only that she's a woman.
Well, you'd hold that against her.
In the context of a bar, yes. I wouldn't personally.
Well, I'm not going to make the slightest distinction between men and women.
That may be a bit hard on the woman.
How do you mean?
Well, there are only four women applying. If none of them is appointed, women's lib may start lying down in the Strand.
They can start getting up again. I'm not going to appoint a woman just to please women's lib. No, no, no. The whole test must be, if she were a man, would she be appointed? If yes, I shall recommend her. If no, well, then I shan't.
Harriet Peterson's pretty good.
Yes, but she may get married again and leave the bar.
I thought you were going to treat them equally with men, Lord Chancellor.
Yes. Yes, you've got a point there. But if she suddenly retired, the bar would be a silk short.
Only for a year or less. She can be replaced then.
Yes, yes, that's true. But you know, I'm not going to give silk to someone who simply wants to retire with distinction. No, no. She must intend to go on practicing. I must have that assurance.
Yes, I can see that.
Now, what about her referees? I mean, Bosanquette's given her a very good reference, but why hasn't she got another judge to back her? And a successful junior ought to be able to manage more than one. I mean, doesn't she get on with judges?
I should think so, but I must say I was surprised myself. I could ask other.
I see you've got her down here as a reserve.
That's if you're going to treat women as men. But if you'd been intent on appointing a woman because she was a woman, I'd have suggested her.
Well, as I said, I'm not. But as this is a close thing, I think you'd better get on to John Gallagher. Have a word with him and let me know what he says.
Sir John Gallagher, Sir Harold.
Come in, John. Nice to see you again.
How are you, Harold? Overworked, I imagine?
If I weren't, I wouldn't admit it. Sherry?
Ah, thank you. You wanted to see me about Harriet Peterson.
Yes. Why did you have to support her application?
Well, I suggested Musgrave. I've no doubt why he turned her down. She was too upset to try anyone else.
Musgrave? That wasn't very bright of you, John. Do sit down.
Ah.
Tell me another thing. Why hasn't she married her doctor friend?
Too keen on the bar.
You see, the Lord Chancellor wouldn't be best pleased if she took silk and then retired to the marriage bed, so to speak.
I see that, nor would I. She's an asset to the bar, and an important one. I'm rather worried about her. If she's refused silk, she might retire altogether.
Is that a threat, John?
My dear fellow, threaten the Lord Chancellor?
You'd threaten the Archbishop of Canterbury, if you thought it necessary.
Thank you, Harold.
Nevertheless, you'd better prepare yourself for the loss. In view of the strength of the other applications, I'd be surprised if she gets it.
Oh. Oh, dear. Well, that's the worst news I've heard for a long time.
I'm sorry.
Puts me in a rather awkward position. Now I've got to pretend I haven't the faintest idea what her chances are. It'll be damn difficult. She's got a man's brain and a woman's intuition. I doubt if I'm a good enough actor.
Oh, come, John, you're a superb actor. You can argue a case in which you have no belief as though your client were unquestionably in the right.
Yes, but not with Harriet Peterson as judge. Bad news, I'm afraid. The silks are out, and you're not one of them.
You can't have seen a list.
No, but those who've got it have been told. It'll be in the papers tomorrow. I take it you haven't had a letter.
Of course not. I'd have told you at once.
I really am terribly sorry. Try not to be too upset. I know that's easy to say. You've had several knocks recently, but don't take this one too hard.
Yes?
Dr. Moody to see you, Miss Peterson.
Just a moment. Someone to see me.
A client?
No. Ian.
Oh. Now, look, Harriet. I really do know what I'm talking about. Now, don't give way to him.
Bill, ask him to come in, please.
Now, Harriet, please, stand firm.
Ah, Sir John.
Yeah, Dr. Moody. Now, don't take up too much of her time. She's got an awful lot to do.
So have I.
Yes. Well, your timing's impeccable, I'm sorry to say.
I've come to apologize. I behaved disgracefully.
So did I.
I'm sorry. I'm desperately sorry.
Well, there's one thing on the credit side today. They turned me down.
Oh. That's rotten luck. I mean it.
Thank you.
You feeling bitter?
Huh? Depressed. Until you walked in.
What's going to happen now?
I don't know. Any suggestions?
No comment.
You wouldn't want me on the rebound, surely.
Try me.
I think Harriet ought to have this at once. It's from the Lord Chancellor's office.
Excuse me. It's a personal note from the Lord Chancellor. You'll probably make me a QC next year.
Ah, good. So sorry to interrupt it.
You're nothing of the sort.
Quite.
You know, I think I'll start banging my head against the wall. It'd be far more relaxing.
Ian, perhaps you should put us out of our misery once and for all. I mean it. I'd understand.
Hungry?
Yeah?
I told the restaurant to keep that Dover sole warm for you. But there'll be no walking out on me at this time.
Why this time?
It's your turn to pay.